Ventura County virtual lecture series. We'll give folks just a couple of minutes to log on. On the screen, you'll find a few reminders about finalizing your registration and completing the evaluation. You see there are two QR codes. You can actually aim those codes with your camera, and that will open up the registration at the beginning and after the event, the evaluation. This registration is necessary. It's different than the one that you used to get into the meeting. We need this one for attendance. This lecture has been recorded, so remember to that you'll have access to it even after this event. Go back and look at it again for reference. Please make sure you keep your microphones muted. See that more people are joining. Thank you. We still have some more announcements to make. We'll get started in just a few minutes. For those who just joined, you'll see our registration and evaluation reminders on the screen. Please make sure that you register. The links are in the chat as well. So you can aim your camera to the QR code on the left, or you can click on the link in the chat box. While we are waiting, please feel free to introduce yourselves in the chat box with your name and organization. And please keep your microphones muted. We're asking that all in attendance viewing both live and as a recording, please complete this second registration so that we know who is here. Many of you may have already completed this step via the SurveyMonkey. Remember, all who register will be entered into a drawing for a custom AAVC prize, so make sure you're registered. The link is in the chat. In your registration, please make sure you have noted whether you are requesting continuing education. For those seeking CME, you must be present for the entirety of this session to receive those credits. So it is 6:01. I'd like to welcome everyone to the AAVC lecture series. I am Tomas Torices, Executive Director of the AAP California Chapter 2, and I will be the moderator for this evening. At this point, I would like to introduce and welcome Dr. Chris Landon.
Hi, everyone. Thank you for joining us for this session that is part of the AAVC Provider Training Lecture Series. We hope this session is both informative and engaging for you. Don't forget to register and complete the evaluation so we know who our audience is and how to improve in the future. All who register, including those who are watching this as a recording, will be entered into a raffle for a special ACES Aware Ventura County Prize. This lecture is being recorded, so you can have access to it on our website at any time. Thank you for joining us on our mission to bring better help, better health, and better hope to Ventura County and beyond.
Thank you, Dr. Landon. Our speakers today are Dr. Ruby Kalra and Dr. Adwoa Osei. They will be presenting on self-care strategies for provider burnout. Dr. Ruby Kalra is a proud parent of three boys, a perennial school volunteer, an elected South Pasadena Unified School District Board of Education member, a certified yoga instructor, and a pediatric subspecialist residing in Southern California. She completed her medical education at the University of Illinois, pediatric internship at LA County USC Medical Center, and pediatric residency at Children's Hospital of Los Angeles. She then completed her pediatric hematology oncology fellowship at the University of California, San Francisco, and is currently working on an integrative medicine fellowship through the Academy of Integrative Health and Medicine. She has an interest in wellness, stress reduction, and mind-body therapies. Dr. Adwoa Osei received her medical degree from the University of Ghana Medical School. She completed residency and chief residency in pediatrics at Michigan State University. After residency, she practiced general pediatrics for several years with Indiana University Health. She is currently an assistant professor at UC Riverside School of Medicine, serving as pediatric curriculum director and a practicing pediatrician with UCR Health. Through her career, Dr. Osei has had a special interest in behavioral and developmental pediatrics and is currently a fellow of the UC Leadership Education in Neurodevelopmental Disabilities. She is particularly interested in the relationship between adverse childhood experiences and neurodiverse children. Her current research interests include measuring and reducing ACEs in Inland Empire, in the inland Southern California, how treatment of parental emotional behavioral disorders affect neurodevelopment in children, and neurodevelopmental assessments in Ghana. Dr. Osei is married, has two children, and enjoys floral photography, baking, and poetry. After the lecture, Dr. Kalra and Dr. Osei will be responding to some pre-submitted questions, as well as audience questions. You are all encouraged to submit questions via the chat box for our speakers to answer during the Q&A session. Now, I'll turn it over to our presentation.
Thank you for the introduction. Again, my name is Ruby Kalra, and today I'll be discussing physician burnout. I'd also like to share some of my own personal self-care strategies, which I find to be helpful in managing stress, and I hope that you too will find these to be helpful. Here are the learning objectives of today's presentation. This training focuses on avoiding burnout and self-care strategies for clinicians. This impacts ACE screening and the treatment of toxic stress as part of trauma-informed care, which includes providing emotional safety for clinicians and that of patients. Self-care for healthcare providers is an essential component of trauma-informed care. Trauma-informed care, including ACE screening and treating toxic stress, involves providing an emotionally safe environment, not only for our patients, but also for clinicians and staff. Data shows that 62% of California residents have experienced one or more ACE, and 16% have experienced four or more ACEs. As this data suggests, we and our office staff are not immune to having experienced at least one ACE. It makes sense to know how to manage personal self-care strategies for ourselves, as these are the same strategies that we recommend to our patients. When thinking about understanding the importance of screening and training providers to respond to patients with trauma-informed care, we must also consider that self-care for healthcare providers is an essential component of trauma-informed clinical care. As healthcare providers, we are at risk of burnout, and we often place our own self-care last. However, we cannot give what we do not have. So let's start by defining physician burnout. Burnout is a syndrome resulting from work-related stress characterized by both emotional and physical exhaustion, expressed as feeling overwhelmed and depleted, depersonalization or loss of empathy, or feeling cynical, detached, or sarcastic, and a reduced sense of personal accomplishment and job satisfaction, or feeling like, what's the use, or doubting the purpose of your work. Stress is not just about the nature of the external stressor, however, because someone's idea of stress might be someone else's idea of something really fun and exciting. Thinking about stress, it's also important to consider resiliency factors, such as having strong social supports or a mindset or an attitude of being able to cope with the stressor. These positive factors can diminish the effects of the stressor. Burnout, however, is more than just stress. With stress, you can sort of replenish with time away. With burnout, no amount of time away helps, because as soon as you return, you're quickly back in that same place of feeling stuck and powerless. Now that I've defined burnout, how do you measure burnout? Typically, burnout is assessed with the Maslach Burnout Inventory, which includes 22 questions measuring three main symptoms of burnout, including exhaustion, depersonalization, and lack of efficacy. In the words of Dr. Maslach herself, burnout is described as an erosion of the soul created by deterioration of one's values, dignity, spirit, and will. Earlier, we touched upon trauma-informed care principles and the need to establish emotional and physical safety for both patients and staff. Trauma-informed care helps us to recognize the signs and symptoms of trauma on physical and mental health. When we build strong, healthy, and safe work relationships, we are better able to address the principles of trauma-informed care and to establish trust with our colleagues and with our patients. Trauma-informed care principles, particularly the first point on the slide, describes how establishing emotional and physical safety for patients and staff serve as a guide for healthcare providers and staff. When we are able to build that relationship of safety, we are better able to address additional principles of trauma-informed care. We will discuss further in this presentation some key ways that we, as professionals, when screening for adverse childhood experiences and familiarizing ourselves with the questionnaires, can address physician burnout and more concrete self-care strategies. In order to provide trauma-informed care, clinician and staff need to avoid burnout. And the seven strategies, which we'll discuss later on, are general strategies, to regulate the stress response. So they too could help reduce burnout. If physicians avoid burnout with yoga and mindfulness, which we'll discuss, then they are better able to screen and provide trauma-informed care. By prioritizing self-care, we can potentially avoid the secondhand negative outcomes of physician burnout. These negative outcomes of burnout include a higher risk of mental health disorders, including anxiety, depression, and suicidality, substance abuse, and higher rates of divorce. Medical errors go up, and the quality of patient care and patient-doctor relationships goes down. The quality of workplace relationships also goes down. So why are we even talking about burnout? Physician burnout is an all-time high, with around half of all physicians reporting having experienced burnout. And this is pre-COVID. Though it's clear there is a need for systems-related changes that we can all work toward and advocate for in our workplaces, it's also important to realize that we are able to positively impact our own sense of well-being and can promote resiliency. Self-care is important because it reduces the victim mentality and the sense of powerlessness inherent in the burnout model. If we are less stressed, we can be more positive toward ourselves, our colleagues, our families, and we can be more healthy and present for our patients. A recent study found a 2.5-fold increased risk of burnout for physicians with four or more ACEs. Practicing compassionate resilience to maintain provider well-being while caring for patients is an important step to combating staff compassion fatigue, burnout, secondary traumatic stress, vicarious trauma, and other workforce concerns. This recent Medscape survey of over 15,000 physicians revealed that 42% of physicians surveyed self-reported as having burnout. And again, this is pre-COVID. Mid-career is the highest time for burnout, and more women than men experience burnout. Long hours, overwhelming workload, and a lack of support are cited as the most common factors contributing to burnout. More and more programs are now offering wellness activities and stress reduction programs to address burnout. However, in this survey, though 28% of workplaces were offering such programs, 42% of physicians surveyed said they probably would not use these programs. The number of physicians not willing to use stress reduction programs makes sense, since from the start of medical school, we are trained to put our own personal needs last and to strive for perfection. These mindsets, however, do not serve us or our families, colleagues, and patients well. In addition to those physicians striving to find a work-life balance, the amount of work required in a typical workplace may not allow for a healthy amount of free time, but choosing another career or specialty shouldn't be the only option available to us. A big part of self-care is recognizing different areas in our lives that require balance to avoid burnout. For those interested in reading more about physician burnout and finding ways to create more balance, I recommend this book by Dr. Drummond, Stop Physician Burnout: What to Do When Working Harder Isn't Enough. No talk on physician self-care would be balanced without admitting that there's a lot of stress in our work lives, and much of it may be out of our personal realm of control. Many physicians may resent the multitude of suggestions to just take care of yourself. I borrowed this quote from Dr. Ma because it shows the irony that we alone are responsible for our suffering and that a yoga class or a gratitude journal may somehow make it all better. Many of us are working in places where we may feel powerless and just another part of a system that isn't aligned with wellness. Though it's clear that there is a need for systems changes that we can all work toward in our workplaces, it's also important to realize that we can positively impact our own sense of well-being and can promote resiliency. Self-care is important because it reduces the victim mentality and the sense of powerlessness inherent in the burnout model. I do believe that we are always in a place to be able to work from within to help ourselves to be more resilient. This can happen at the same time that we're advocating for more humane systems in our workplaces. For me, psychiatrist Viktor Frankl sums it up nicely in his classic book entitled Man's Search for Meaning, stating that, quote, everything can be taken from a man, but one thing, the last of the human freedoms, to choose one's attitude in any given set of circumstances, to choose one's own way, end quote. We cannot avoid suffering, but we can choose how to cope with it, to find meaning in it, and to move forward. Our goal is to find meaning in life through our actions, our work, and our relationships. Many of us chose medicine because we wanted to find meaning and purpose in helping others. I appreciate Dr. Horton's comment, quote, if we think that the only solution to addressing physician burnout is fixing the system, we risk internalizing the idea that all solutions are entirely out of our control, end quote. If we are less stressed, we can be more positive toward ourselves, our families, and coworkers, and more healing for our patients. These evidence-based strategies for mitigating the toxic stress response may also be helpful strategies to mitigate burnout. Building resilience in the workforce involves creating environments in which staff can maintain a compassionate presence in all interactions with patients, their families, and colleagues while maintaining their own well-being. 7 evidence-based strategies for toxic stress mitigation from the Surgeon General's report, Roadmap for Resilience, include supportive relationships, high quality, sufficient sleep, balanced nutrition, regular physical activity, mindfulness and meditation, experiencing nature, behavioral and mental health care. These strategies offer an integrative approach to ACE and toxic stress intervention. A good start is to just choose one or two things that resonate with you and that you can slowly incorporate into your life over time. My favorite tools are mindfulness practices and yoga. Both of these we will discuss further. I have been practicing yoga for 19 years, and in 2018, I actually completed my 200-hour yoga teacher training. Interestingly, I first heard about ACEs through a trauma-informed yoga class that I took. And I'd like to share that yoga is a series of teachings, including philosophy, physical postures, breath regulation, and meditation. It originated in India about 5,000 years ago, and it was first introduced to the U.S. in 1893. In fact, American essayist Henry David Thoreau considered himself to be a yogi or yoga practitioner. Yoga's popularity has been steadily rising, and there are over 37 million practitioners of yoga in the U.S. alone. While I was doing my yoga teacher training, interestingly, a number of teachers would often share that they were seeing more and more students coming into their classes, and those students were sent there by their physicians. In adults, the most commonly used complementary and alternative medicine therapies are non-vitamin, non-mineral, natural products, deep breathing exercises, meditation, chiropractic or osteopathic manipulation, and yoga, acupuncture, and breathing exercises. The literature supports using a variety of techniques, including yoga, acupuncture, and breathing techniques and bioneurofeedback for a variety of things, especially things like pain clinics. Most people who aren't familiar with yoga generally have one of two ideas of yoga. Either you're just lying there doing nothing at all, or maybe you're kind of contorted into a pretzel type pose that just doesn't even seem possible. However, there are many different styles of yoga, and more studios are catering to people with specific medical needs such as cancer. You just have to find the style of yoga that's appropriate for you, as well as the right teacher for you. The National Center for Complementary and Integrative Health website states that according to a 2017 national survey, 1 in 7 adults practiced yoga in the past 12 months, and 1 in 12 children ages 4 to 17 also practiced yoga in the last 12 months. Yoga is primarily known for stress reduction, decreasing anxiety, and improving mood. However, it can also boost joint health, balance, sleep, immune function, and potentially longevity with the increased production of telomerase. There are many articles in the literature addressing the specific benefits of yoga. This meta-analysis of 81 studies found yoga to be as effective or better than exercise in improving a number of health-related measured outcomes, including heart rate variability, blood glucose, blood lipids, salivary cortisol, and oxidative stress. Yoga has been used effectively to help people manage fatigue, pain, and insomnia. Yoga and mindfulness meditation have both tapped into the power of breath regulation to create a sense of calm by stimulating the parasympathetic nervous system. By simply prolonging our exhalation, we can slow down our heart rate by stimulating the parasympathetic nervous system. Research is always ongoing to try and find a clinical diagnostic tool or criteria or biomarker for the toxic stress response, such as using salivary cortisol levels or heart rate variability. But the truth is, there is no real good test for toxic stress. We do know that exposure to ACEs, especially in the absence of protective factors, can alter the biological response, disrupt the development of the neuroendocrine, immune, metabolic, and genetic regulatory mechanisms, and lead to a toxic stress response, thus increasing the risk for health problems, including physical, mental, and behavioral issues. While the psychiatric and behavioral implications of ACEs and toxic stress are those most commonly recognized, the neuroendocrine and immune dysregulation characteristics of the toxic stress response are often overlooked. It is important to recognize the purpose of ACE screening is not specifically to identify an ACE per se, but to identify patients at risk for developing toxic stress or experiencing ACE-associated health conditions. And so, the best predictor of whether a patient is at risk for toxic stress responses and potentially experiencing a toxic stress physiology is cumulative adversity. And so that's the reason why we screen for ACEs and why we teach tools such as yoga and mindfulness to manage stress. This review, looking at 11 different studies on yoga to manage stress and burnout, specifically in healthcare workers, showed that yoga is effective in the prevention and management of musculoskeletal and psychological issues. In addition to the improvement in physical problems and quality of sleep, both stress levels and burnout are consistently reduced in subjects who practice yoga techniques and mind-body meditation. Yoga and other mind-body techniques are often taught in pain clinics and integrative medical practices. Dr. Van der Kolk's book, The Body Keeps the Score, is an excellent resource for the interested reader. Creating your own yoga practice can be daunting, just like adding in any new routine to your life. In my own personal experience, I would recommend adding a few stretches when you first wake up in the morning, such as child's pose while still in bed. Or if mornings are too hectic for you, choose another time of day. Even sitting at your desk and adding a few chair yoga poses can be helpful. There are a variety of different types of yoga, so I highly recommend trying out different instructors and different yoga studios until you find the right fit for you. Many studios are currently offering virtual classes as well. A good teacher will offer you the use of yoga props, such as blankets, bolsters, and blocks to make the poses more accessible for your body. Props are a great way to bring the floor to you. It's important that teachers recognize that they are teaching the pupil and not the pose. Yoga injuries do happen from overstretching in poses and sometimes from vigorous yoga adjustments from teachers. In fact, more and more yoga teachers are now backing away from manual adjustments and using more verbal cues in order to avoid injuries. For further reading, I've listed 3 good books about yoga here for you to look at. And I've also included a few additional references on the benefits of yoga. Mindfulness is a purposeful awareness of the present moment, simply observing with no judgment. It is often tied to the breath, as the breath is always with us. But it could be just as easy to find a different point of focus. One could use sound, walking meditations, eating mindfully. And though I've used the words simple and easy, mindfulness isn't simple or easy, as distractions are always present. The key is to recognize the distraction and gently but firmly return to one's primary focus. In addition, Non-judging is important. No one is a bad meditator. It's normal for the mind to wander, and in fact, recognizing it each time is part of meditating. We become more skilled with more opportunities to recognize straying and to return to the focus. The benefits of meditation can be felt in just 16 seconds, 4 seconds of inhaling, 4 seconds of holding the breath, 4 seconds of exhaling, and 4 additional seconds of holding that breath. Sometimes you could pause and think to yourself, I'm just going to try this before entering a patient room. 16 seconds and maybe a door to more calm visit. Or you might simply choose to repeat a mindful mantra, something like, I am calm, compassionate, capable, and caring, right before walking into a room. Mindfulness has been shown to increase the activity and connectivity of the higher brain centers while also decreasing the activity of the amygdala or the alarm center. Stress causes our thinking brain or prefrontal cortex to shut down and our alarm center to take over. This process is sometimes referred to as emotional hijacking, as first described by Daniel Goleman, who wrote Emotional Intelligence in 1995. In fact, chronic stress actually leads to a larger amygdala and a decreased connectivity to the higher thinking centers of the brain. With meditation, the ability to be aware of emotional hijacking leads to the ability to reconnect more quickly to our thinking brain and to strengthening these neural connections. Mindfulness has also been associated with decreased sympathetic activation, lower blood pressure, and improved parasympathetic activity with increasing heart rate variability. Mindfulness has been found to decrease provider stress and burnout, improve patient-centered care, increase empathy, improve patient satisfaction, and reduce implicit bias. Mindfulness also decreases parental stress and improves the caregiver-child relationship. And here are some online resources available to help you start a meditation practice. All are free. I would start with the UCLA Mindful app for guided meditations. Headspace is a pretty popular app as well, but it does have a fee. And I'd also be happy to share additional information with you about the mindfulness-based stress reduction program. My on and off meditation practice really changed into a more consistent practice after I took the 8-week mindfulness-based stress reduction course created by Dr. Jon Kabat-Zinn. Dr. Jon Kabat-Zinn was a molecular biology graduate student at MIT in the late 1960s and early 1970s when he became very interested in Buddhism and began practicing meditation. In 1979, he started a mindfulness-based stress reduction group in the basement room at the University of Massachusetts Medical Center to help patients with chronic pain. He was careful to leave out any religious or spiritual overtones and coined the term mindfulness instead. As more and more patients began to feel better, more physicians began to refer patients that no one else knew what to do with, and eventually, even the doctors began to attend the sessions. I've listed a few references here on mindfulness as a starting point for you. Here are 4 additional books for you to look at if you're so interested. So by now, hopefully you're feeling heavily meditated, or at least hoping to feel heavily meditated in the future. Thank you for participating in this session. I will now turn it over to Dr. Osei, who will talk a bit more about some effective self-care strategies.
Thank you, Dr. Kalra, for that wonderful presentation. I'm going to go ahead and talk about some self-care strategies that we can use as physicians as we deal with patients who have been through adverse experiences, and also even for ourselves, because I'm pretty sure some of us have been through some adverse childhood experiences as well. So today I'm going to be talking about a model that I discovered from one of my colleagues. He used to be a former psychologist, now an ED physician. He introduced this scientific model theory to me, and it's been a game changer in terms of how I approach my well-being and growth. What I do like about the model that we're going to be talking about is that it's evidence-based, and it's one of the seven models discussed in recent articles addressing physician wellness. So by the end of this presentation, I hope to leave you with at least one new skill in caring for yourself. So what is this model that I'm talking about? It's called the PERMA model, and this is credited to Dr. Seligman in his book Flourish, published in 2011. In this book, he introduced a well-being theory made up of five blocks, independent of each other. He specifically states that no one element defines well-being, but each contributes to it. So basically, when all these blocks are practiced, one can be described as flourishing. This theory accounts for objective and subjective measurements of well-being. And I have to say that a lot of his work was done in the military, what he calls post-traumatic growth. Later, he described what is now known as the biology of optimism. And so as you can see here, there are five components of PERMA. So we have positive emotion, we have engagement, we have positive relationships, we have meaning, and we have accomplishment. And as we go through this presentation, I will try to weave how all of these signs are connected into helping one flourish or create a sense of sustainable well-being. How does this translate into what we're talking about? So for us in the medical field, or I would say in the scientific field, this is really important because we do have literature that tells us about some of the mental health benefits and some of the physical health benefits when we incorporate care and into our self-care, what we now call positive psychology. So what we've known in the past and we still continue to discover is that in terms of mental health benefits, expressing gratitude contributes to an overall sense of well-being. It relieves depression and depressive symptoms, and it improves relationships. For physical health benefits, we can talk about how this helps improve heart rate variability and disease severity goes down significantly. It also reduces disease progression, and he did a lot of this work looking at cardiovascular disease and also some cancer studies as well. It also does help decrease the frequency of ailments, and when you do get sick, it actually shortens stuff for you as well. So as you can tell, this model goes a long way in giving us some positive results when it comes to aside of practicing medicine and also in our self-care. The big thing about PERMA is that once you begin to look at each of these components, they kind of intertwine and they feed off each other. So let's take a few minutes to kind of talk about the different components in brief detail. Let's talk about positive emotions. When you have positive emotions, it enables us to broaden our awareness, leading to the acquisition of new resources. I mean, it may have been mentioned earlier on, but I'm a pediatrician. And one thing we do know in the pediatric world is that when a child feels safe and encouraged, they do really, really well at learning. It's the same for us as adults, as physicians. When we feel safe, when we have a lot of positive emotions, we're more likely to learn new skills, right? And so one thing that I need to mention here is that positive emotions, they rarely happen in isolation, right? It's not solitary. A lot of the times, if you pay attention, positive emotions are happening because you're experiencing them with other people. So this is key, right? This is what I mean by these blocks kind of feed into each other. Because then if you're going to have positive emotions and you need people to experience that, well, that takes us to relationships, right? And this is where Dr. Seligman talks about safe, stable, nurturing, supportive relationships. Very key as you begin to work on that sense of well-being or flourishing. Another component that he has brought into this conversation is engagement. And this he describes as something that one is willing to do for its own sake. So there are no rewards. You're just kind of in the flow. You're not necessarily in a happy place. You just got lost in it, right? And it doesn't matter if it's difficult or dangerous, but it's just that flow. With that comes meaning. Finding meaning is an ongoing active process. Every day, whatever interactions that we encounter, experiences that we go through, they do shape our experience of meaningfulness, right? Meaning enables us to perceive that our lives matter and that we're part of something bigger than ourselves. That also then leads to accomplishment, right? And so as I'm talking, you're beginning to see how all these blocks are intertwined. And I have to add that they don't necessarily need to follow that order. You can toggle these blocks in different ways across your life, in a day, in a week, in a month. In terms of accomplishment, it's that sense of working towards accomplishing a goal and having the mastery, or being able to access the skills to master that task and to complete it. The key point here is that goals can be tiny, they can be minuscule, they can be scattered, or it can be a large thing. The whole point is that you have something that you're working towards too. So I fell in love with this model because it brings in all the different types of evidence-based stress busters highlighted in the ACEs Aware initiative by the SGO. It gives me and my patients and my colleagues multiple tools for well-being and flourishing, such that if we run low in one block, we can easily dip into another block to sort of replenish ourselves. You're not just relying on one thing, right? A key example is, for example, you get a pay cut, right? You could say that positive emotions really run low because nobody likes to get a pay cut. However, that allows you to now focus on maybe doing something meaningful that allows you to hone in on your skills, leading to a sense of accomplishment, which even though you started off with decreased positive emotions, because now you have a sense of accomplishment and you're now doing something meaningful, well, guess what? Positive emotions goes up again, right? So, and who knows, now that you're doing something meaningful and you're working on something to accomplish, who knows what relationships you build along the way, right? So now you have positive relationships along the way as well. And so that's just a quick way of how the PERMA model really gives you the groundwork to start flourishing or working towards sustainable well-being. So at this moment, we're going to take a little break and do a little practice that he highlights in his book. This is my modified version, and I'll strongly encourage you to get his book. It's called Flourish, A New Approach to Well-Being. But what I'm going to have you do is just think of a time someone did something kind for you. Just take a moment. How did you feel? Now close your eyes, breathe, and express gratitude to that person. Good. How are you feeling? Right? Take a moment to write that down. That's what we mean by all the different blocks building off each other, right? Someone did something positive. That was a supportive relationship, right? However short or quick that was, it garnered positive emotion that you can still pull up now. I don't know when that happened, right? And you going back and writing that down is also leading to more positive emotions. And some might even argue meaning, depending on how you choose to interpret that experience. In his book, he takes it to a whole different level. He calls it the gratitude visit, which basically means you write a letter of gratitude, you deliver it in person and read it to the person who did the act of kindness to you, uninterrupted though. And after the letter is read, the two of you sit down and talk about how you feel and the content of that letter. And he does say that it actually decreases depression a month from when this exercise happened. So something to think about. So now I'm going to transition into what the Surgeon General's office has actually put out for stress busters, all right? And again, I love the PERMA model because it really brings in what you see projected on this slide. So for example, supportive relationships. Well, we already have that for R in PERMA, right? high quality sufficient sleep. We have that in the H. So modified versions of the PERMA model now include an H after the A, which stands for health, right? So physical activity, good sleep, good nutrition, which you can see listed here in the stress busters from the SGO office. Dr. Carr already talked about mindfulness and meditation. Definitely that does improve positive emotions. And also, in depending on what you're meditating on, gives you some meaning, right? Access to nature, engagement right there, positive emotions and also meaning, right? I mean, I know that when I'm out there looking at my garden and looking at the butterflies and hummingbirds do their thing, I'm like, oh, there's nothing to worry about. Life still goes on, the sun still shines. So that's one way that you can definitely get the positive emotions and engagement going on. And of course, the key thing here, which, you know, we've been talking about through this series, is behavioral and mental health care. That is so important, right? Positive emotions, meaning accomplishment. I mean, the fact that you even decide to show up in the first place, that alone is an accomplishment. And so looking at this, these stress busters, you can easily see how that PERMA model brings it all together for us. So I try to practice PERMA in many areas of my life, and this slide just basically illustrates some of the tools that I incorporate PERMA day-to-day, weekly, monthly, yearly basis. I have to stress that it's in no particular order. In a day, I can pick up different tools and skills from these blocks and utilize them as needed. And so what you can see here, for example, for positive emotions, what I do a lot of reflective journaling, gratitude practice. The key word is practice because it's hard. Nature walk-ins and sit-ins, and reading fiction, right? Especially with us physicians, it's always about reading the latest journal and this and that. Just reading for fun, like it does not have to make sense. For engagement, I do a lot of creating with my hands. I bake a lot, I craft, I paint, I do a lot of gardening, photography, honing in my skill. I'm a pediatrician, but I'm honing in my skill in behavioral and developmental pediatrics, right? I would argue that that is also, I can also translate that into accomplishment and meaning, right? Because this is something that I really love to do. And then for relationships, right? Mentoring students, colleagues, and being mentored myself. The supportive, stable relationship that I have with my family, and also creating intentional friendships, friendships that are really, that help me thrive and grow. For meaning, again, the key word here is practice, letting go practice, right? Just letting go of things that I don't need or do not help me. The key word is practice. It is hard. Contemplative faith-based practice. Putting things in perspective, you know, kind of looking at the bigger picture. I do a lot of Mary Oliver's poetry as well. And when it comes to philanthropy, I tend to be a bit selective and intentional about where my time, money, and resources go. And then a lot of my long drives, I do a lot of podcasts as well. And then for accomplishment, I already talked about honing my niche and my strengths in my career field, in this case, which would be developmental and behavioral pediatrics. Teaching medical students, finding parenting hacks, because, you know, you want to be smart and effective. Celebrating small wins and victories, and really working on valuing journeys and experiences as, you know, we do life. And then, of course, for the H, again, which is the modified version of the PERMA model, sleep, yoga, stretching, dance. I'm not a gym person, so these are my go-to things. Taking time off and away from family and friends. So these are some quick ways that I have found over the years to incorporate PERMA in my self-care and well-being. I do use these tools in my practice as well, and it's something for you to consider. So again, I'm a pediatrician. I see families and children, and all pediatricians here joining me know that a lot of the times we're treating parents and not necessarily the children. And so we do. I do encourage my families to do reflective journaling with their children. Right? It can be audio, video, written, whatever mode they choose, and this draws in, you know, the M for meaning, the P for positive emotions, and then the E for engagement for my families. In my preschool children, I have noticed that especially for those of them who tend to be super anxious in new environments, or in my children who live with autism or see the world differently, you know, creating color-coded charts for emotional regulation has been very helpful. And there's that sense of accomplishment when they figure out, you know, what is red, green, and yellow? When do I need to take it down? And when am I, when I have permission to kind of let go and scream all I want. Also family picture books for some of my younger children, so that when they're away, they don't feel so separated and anxious. Again, working on those relationships and positive emotions. And then identifying strengths during visits and building on them. And there are all sorts of mnemonics to help identify buffering resilience factors in families and children when they come into your office. But that really, really helps with the accomplishment part and the positive emotions. And one of my favorites is music and movement. Basically, I tell my patients to dance like no one is watching. That's how we get our physical activity going on. So at this time, thank you so much for joining us and for listening. I'm really hoping that you've been able to take away at least one skill or begin to look at incorporating the PERMA model in your journey of well-being and flourishing. For those of you joining us live, please join us in a demonstration of music and movement, which will be happening in a few minutes. I'm gonna close by sharing these slides. These are some of my go-to resources for physician self-care. So the PERMA model, you can find that on Authentic Happiness through UPenn. And then Stanford has a wonderful website for physician wellness as well. Thank you so much for joining us.
Well, thank you, Dr. Kalra and Dr. Osei, for that informative presentation. Dr. Osei is now going to lead us in an exercise of music and movement. So I will go ahead and turn it over to her.
Thank you, Tomas, and thank you all for being here. I'm going to play a short session of music, and I encourage you to find the most comfortable seat in position and relax. Just, you know, just let yourself, let your shoulders drop, take in deep breaths, and really move with the music. I highly recommend we do this with our eyes closed so that there is no judgment at all. And let me know how you feel after. So here goes.
Well, thank you so much for that activity, Dr. Osei. We'll have time to have the Q&A in a few minutes. The on the screen right now is information on how to get certified for screen, to screen for ACEs. And how do you get certified? Clinical team members who bill Medi-Cal must complete a certified ACEs aware core training and attest to completing the training to qualify to receive Medi-Cal payments for conducting ACEs screenings. This is what is called the Becoming ACEs Aware in California training. There's a free 2-hour online training that certifies eligible clinicians to receive Medi-Cal payments for ACEs screenings. Clinicians and clinical team members will receive 2 continuing medical education credits and 2 maintenance of certification, the MOC credits, upon completion, and are encouraged to join the ACEs Aware clinician directory. So be sure that you complete that so that you can actually get certified and be paid for the screenings that you perform. We will now start the Q&A portion of this presentation. You are all encouraged to submit questions via the chat box for our presenters to answer during this time, or use the raise your hand function and we'll call on you and have you unmute your microphone. You may also continue to type your questions into the chat box as you go along. So now what we're gonna do, I apologize, my camera was off. We will first share a few of our presenters' responses to some of the pre-submitted questions. And after that, we will go into the live and interactive version of our Q&A. Thank you for being with us. Okay, so I guess we're having the live Q&A at this moment. I don't know if Dr. Osei was able to fix the audio issue. Dr. Kalra is with us. And I am looking at, I don't see any raised hands yet. You can put in your questions in the chat. I'm trying to find, see if there's any questions already. And if anybody can see anyone raising a hand, let me know, because I'm hoping I'm looking at the right thing. Yeah, well, I personally want to thank you, Dr. Osei and Dr. Kalra, for your presentations. We're getting thank yous in the chat box.
We covered everything. There are no questions. Everyone's ready to go home and meditate. Oh, there is a question popping up as I say this.
Yeah, actually there's a question from Amy Lawrence. It says, Dr. Kalra, I wonder if you could say more about the balance of personal responsibility for self-care and organizational responsibility.
That's a great question. And certainly I alluded to the fact that a lot of things are out of our control. I think more and more organizations are starting to value the fact that treating each other with respect is very important, especially for retaining qualified and healthy staff members. But honestly, I just keep coming back to the fact that there is so much that is in our power. And when we think that we don't have any power at all is when we really sink down deeper and deeper into that bad, you know, toxic stress hole. And so I think it's important that we take responsibility for whatever small things we can get, even if it's that, you know, 10 minutes of going outside and sitting on the patio, you know, and soaking up some sunshine, getting some nature. Or as I said, for me, sometimes at a really busy day, I really do try and pause and tell myself, you know, what does this patient need? What do I, you know, how do I want to have the best interaction? Because we've all walked into a room and just been kind of flustered and just not ready. And you kind of wish, oh, I wish I had a restart. And you end up spending a lot of time having to get back to a place where you can actually deliver what both of you need and that relationship. So I think pausing can be a big thing, but excellent question. In so many ways that we each have to find daily how best to manage what we can do for ourselves and what our institutions can be prompted to do for all of us.
Dr. Osei, I actually have a question for you because we had a technical difficulty and there was a, I don't know if it was only on my end, but the music faded away. I just wanted to ask you, how do you see the use of music, especially that one song, to bring wellness upon ourselves?
So in general, music depends on what you're listening with, but it has a very powerful effect on your mood. And so being very selective about what you listen to and when you listen to it, and that's why I guess Spotify is making a lot of money, right, with all these playlists that they create for you. However, I have found that with every presentation I run, when I play this music, I first experienced this. I've always known Bob Marley, but you know, didn't really pay much attention to what he sang. I was at a conference and we listened to this song, and man, it was mood changing for us. Everybody felt relaxed and, you know, our shoulders dropped. It just brought us back to remember that this is bigger than you. Remember that life goes on. Remember that, you know, it puts things in perspective. And so I have found that anytime I introduce this to my patients or even to my colleagues, it has changed the mood in the room. You know, we can laugh, we can regroup, we can win.
Fantastic. Thank you so much. Well, I don't see any more hands raised. I want to thank our two speakers for this fantastic presentations. And I want to thank everyone for attending. I hope you all feel better informed on how to incorporate some of these useful self-care strategies into your own lives, both professionally and personally. Thank you so much.
Well, and Tomas, please, there's a hand raised.
There is.
James Willock has a hand raised.
Okay. If you can unmute your microphone, please go ahead and
Sorry about the delay. I was trying to type it in when you were looking for hands.
Okay.
But not fast enough. So I had a question. Like, I get self-care is so important, and I'm a community intervention worker as well as crisis responder. And so it's like, it's basically nonstop. So my question is, do you believe that there's a certain amount of like hours or a certain amount of days or that you should take for yourself, like to do the self-care? Because like we can go a month or something without getting a break. And so and even though that my organization does have like, you know, PTA, you know, personal days off and stuff like that, it's still hard to find time, you know, throughout the day. Like right now, you know, I'm, you know, still working, you know, I'm still on the clock. And so is there a certain amount of time that you should take this mandatory, do you believe?
I think that's a great question. And I think the answer is that it's really variable and independent. I think different people, depending on what resiliency factors that they have in their lives, allow them to be able to extend more or maybe not. There's times in our life when we really don't have the wherewithal to add in and need more time. So there's so many factors, whether it be resiliency factors or independent individual sort of makeup and how one addresses different things in people's lives. But yeah, we can't run on empty. And that's a definite, when you feel that need, that's your body telling you, your signal that, you know, I need time. And being able to advocate for yourself for that time is very important.
I'm gonna add to what Dr. Kalra has just said, that I think a great place to start from would be to, I'm not sure what faith you practice or what traditions you practice, but in almost every faith or ancient religious faith practice, whatever it is, typically, if you look closely, there is one day that has been built in for rest. So that's a good place to start if you're looking for, you know, how many hours or how many days should I take? Taking a day off, there is wisdom behind that. It kind of gives you that space to regroup and reset. So that would be a good place to start from. It doesn't necessarily need to be a Monday to day appointed by anyone, but just kind of carving that day out for yourself. It helps. Now, I also understand the complexities. You know, it's very easy for us to sit here and say, take time off and do this. But when you have bills to pay, when you have people to feed, you know, it's really challenging. So some authors do advocate for taking what they describe as minuscule moments of joy or minuscule moments of rest. So kind of scattered throughout the day. And that's what, you know, Dr. Kalra mentioned, you know, 16 seconds here, 16 seconds there, 16, it quickly adds up. But the whole point is that you are in control. You made this choice to take this time, to build this time into whatever is happening. And, you know, that increases that self-efficacy, that sense of accomplishment, and also helps grow the positive emotions for you.
Well, thank you to both of you. I don't see any more hands raised. We've come to the end of our program. I want to thank everyone who attended tonight. Thank you for your questions and for your attendance. Thank you to our speakers. And please stay on for some important reminders from the Landon Pediatric Foundation ACES grant coordinators.
Thank you again for watching this lecture. Remember to complete the registration and evaluation. We will contact you soon if you are one of our raffle winners, so stay tuned.
Make sure to follow us on all our social media accounts and subscribe on our webpage for more information of our 12 lecture series, ACES Aware Ventura County, and all things ACES Aware.
Thank you for joining us on our mission to bring better help,
better health,
and better hope to Ventura County and beyond.
Bye. See you at our next session.
Thank you all for joining tonight. We do have these final reminders with our QR codes on the screen. If you have any questions, you can email us at acesaware@ventura.org. Our upcoming sessions will be posted on our website as well, so feel free to visit those. And our next session is on motivational interviewing next Tuesday on the 28th. So we hope to see you there. Thank you.